What's going on, smart people? My name's Dylan. I'm a physicist, and I've had a bunch of requests to do a video where I explain the science behind Interstellar. Now, I was hesitant to do this at first because it's been done to death, and not to mention Kip Thorne himself, a Nobel Prize-winning physicist, and the guy who wrote the script, has a bunch of lectures online that explains exactly this. So, but you know, if you guys want to hear my thoughts, let's dance. Let's do it. So I'm basically just going to try and explain the end for you so you can understand what was going on when he went into the black hole and how he arrived where he did at the end. I think the rest has kind of been done to death, explained very well in many, many videos I've seen, but this particular aspect and the physics underlying it are a bit more complex and subtle, and goes into theoretical physics stuff. So I thought we could just sort of focus on that. And there's plenty to talk about. So if you'd like to learn more about all the other stuff, like the time dilation and all the other bits of the film, I highly suggest going and watching Kip Thorne's lectures on the film. He explains it, and he's got a great sense of humor. So go check those out. I'm just doing this spontaneously. I've written down a couple key points, but there's no script, so let's go. First and foremost, I'm a huge Christopher Nolan fan. He is a great director. All of his films are really interesting, have great stories, and he does love exploring science. I remember seeing that he was making this film a couple years before it actually came out, and I saw the title, and he was directing, so I was eagerly awaiting the release of this film. And when I saw it, I was blown away. I absolutely loved it. Everything about it, the story, the music, all the 2001 references. I remember seeing in an interview that Interstellar is actually kind of like Nolan's ode to that film, which is super cool. 2001 is hands down my favorite film. And there were so many references to it, like Tars, his whole character essentially. But you know, the shape of him being like a monolith from 2001, even the name. So that was all fantastic, and there's so many other things. But anyway, let's get to the physics. So if you clicked on this video, I'm sure you know that the film used some real mathematics. So Kip Thorne, you know, who's an expert on black holes and everything like that, provided some real math behind black holes for the visual effects department of behind Interstellar. And yeah, they created this black hole that they were actually able to publish some real science about. Kip Thorne, for this story, has borrowed a lot of stuff from theoretical physics and just sort of assumed that it's true to make the story work. A lot of this stuff, you know, might not be true in reality whatsoever. To give an example, like general relativity, assuming that what it tells us is happening on the inside of a black hole is true. General relativity suggests that there are things inside black holes called singularities which have infinite densities. You can't avoid them. The math of general relativity, you get infinities. Singularities being inside black holes is theoretical. It's not proven whatsoever. And the infinities invoked by these singularities raise a lot of physicists' eyebrows. Whenever, like I just said, whenever infinities are invoked, it's somewhat alarming. Many physicists don't believe that infinities in nature are even meaningful. Because in the past, whenever infinities pop up in our equations, it suggests a limit of our understanding of nature, a limit of our description of nature, a limit of our equations, not a limit of nature. So I am not convinced that singularities are inside black holes. It could be a whole lot more boring than that, unfortunately. It could just be little bits of really dense matter, like in, say, a neutron star. Maybe we should back up just for a minute and talk about general relativity. Now, I don't think general relativity is going to be fundamental. I think space and time, space-time, will emerge from something more fundamental. Whether it is string theory, twister theory, or a whole bunch of others, I'm not sure, and no one is currently. One of the reasons we know that general relativity, this must be the case for it, is because it doesn't treat matter as quantum mechanical, which we know it is. If you'd like to look more into this, I highly suggest Nima Armani Ahmed's public lectures. He's a professor at the Institute of Advanced Study, which is where Einstein did some of his work. And he's regarded as one of the most creative theoretical physicists currently working. So I highly suggest going and checking that out. Now, I'm not saying general relativity is wrong. I'm saying that space-time might be an emergent thing. Its equations still provide perfectly adequate answers. But as to what's really fundamental in the universe, I think is going to be a bit more strange. And what gravity truly is, rather than just the curvature of space-time, might turn out to be something even more incredible. But anyway, let's describe the reality that general relativity presents so we can understand interstellar. So in general relativity, there's three spatial dimensions. That is, you need three numbers to describe someone's position in space. But Einstein showed there's actually another measurement you need to describe someone's position in space, and that's their position in time. You need to know their position in time as well as their three spatial dimensions if you want to be able to define where someone is. And that measurement of time is what we call, we define it as the fourth dimension. So you see that's the spatial and this temporal dimension is wrapped up in the kind of one thing, which is what we call space-time. Now, before I continue, we don't really understand what time is. General relativity and quantum mechanics, which are the two greatest theories of physics, present conflicting ideas as to what it is. That's a bit of a problem. If you want to know more about that, I suggest going and watching my Tenet video where I talk about this in a bit more depth. I explain how time is viewed in both of those theories, how entropy is related to time, and how it is often confused with time. So go and check out that video. I'll put it in the description. Now, Interstellar actually goes further than just these four dimensions. It explores the fifth dimension, which is completely theoretical. This is something only theoretical physicists think is a real thing. There's zero evidence for its existence thus far. And in their lingo, we call the three spatial dimensions and the one time dimension as the brain. Now, if you try and imagine these three spatial dimensions in a two-dimensional space, you can imagine it kind of like a flat sheet. So you essentially have to take away one of the spatial dimensions and you get this flat sheet, which is the brain, which is short for membrane. And this brain, this flat sheet, lives within a higher dimensional bulk, which is everything surrounding the brain. So you can imagine the flat sheet like our universe, and the fifth dimension is like the space around us, which we don't have access to. Now let's imagine putting a black hole in this flat sheet. First, you need to understand that when you put mass or energy in this flat sheet, it bends the flat sheet. So mass and energy are the same thing. Einstein showed us that. And what he also showed us with general relativity is that when you put these things in this brain, it will curve it. Why it curves it? Well, no one knows the answer to that question just yet. But I can tell you that it does curve it. And what this curvature is what we call gravity, at least in general relativity's perspective. So you can imagine that if you put something with mass in this flat sheet, it, let's say, bends down, it curves. So what is it bending into? What is it curving into? The bulk, the fifth dimension. So put something with mass inside this flat sheet and it curves it. And you have to give it some motion because everything in the universe has motion. So everything with motion in this flat sheet will follow a straight line. But there are no straight lines in space-time because of the curves everywhere. But there's another trick. So what we call a straight line in, the closest we can get to a straight line is what we call a geodesic, which is a straight line in curved space. It's as straight as possible. So this mass with its motion, when you put it in the sheet, will follow the curvature of space-time. Because it's really just trying to follow a straight line, but a straight line in space-time is curved. So say you put the sun in this flat sheet and you put the earth in there too, but because the earth has a lot less mass than the sun, it curves this flat sheet a lot less. So what ends up happening is the earth follows these geodesics, the dented curved space that the sun has enforced on this flat sheet. So Earth is just trying to follow a straight line in curved space. Okay, now you got that. Imagine putting a black hole in this flat sheet. What do you think is going to happen? It's going to curve this flat sheet, right? But by how much? Well, according to general relativity, an infinite amount. It curves it all the way down to infinity. But like we've already mentioned, inside black holes, there might not be any infinities. There might not be singularities. They sure as hell do bend space an enormous amount when you look at them from the outside. But inside the black hole, general relativity suggests this singularity has infinite density and it's curving this space-time to infinity. It's essentially tearing space-time. It's just, you know, it doesn't make a lot of sense, does it? So Interstellar assumes that black holes do have singularities inside them and that these singularities curve space-time to infinity, curve it into the bulk, an infinite amount. Now, if you could manipulate this curving into the bulk and make it so it curves into another place on this flat sheet, so let's just rehash, you're putting something like a black hole in this flat sheet, it curves it infinite amount, and you control that curvature and bring it back on itself to another spot on this flat sheet. Well, that's essentially what a wormhole is. Can they exist in nature? Well, no one knows. There's no evidence for either way, and we really can't be sure of anything currently. So don't listen to anyone that says things are impossible. Who knows what's possible? All right, so that pretty much explains to you how the end of the film works. When Matthew McConaughey's character goes into the black hole, how he gets over to, I think he's near Saturn, or is it Jupiter? Anyway, he's floating off in space and he has like minutes left of oxygen. And it's a number of years into the future. So when Matthew McConaughey's character goes into the black hole, that's what's happening. There's a wormhole. The curvature of the flat sheet, the brain, is curving back on itself to another spot in the flat sheet, which is where he ends up, floating out near Saturn or Jupiter, I think it is, with minutes left in his oxygen tank. And, you know, it's only so many years into the future of back in that timeline on Earth. And another thing you actually need to understand how he gets over there is that when he first goes into the black hole, he arrives in that weird place. And that's what Kip Thorne is basically saying is a tesseract, which is like a four-dimensional analog to a cube. So it's like a four-dimensional cube, right? And that tesseract is, you know, floating in the bulk, which is the fifth dimension. And who created that? Well, in the movie, they suggest like, I can't remember what they call them, but I think it's basically suggesting it's future humans who have created this tesseract thing in that can transport through the bulk. So I guess this tesseract is the vehicle through the bulk, basically allowing the wormhole to function. I don't know. Now, there's a lot of other really cool physics in the movie that I'm not going to talk about. I think that'll probably just about do it. All the stuff about time dilation, the going across the event horizon of the black hole, there's lots of other cool things that I could talk about, but it's been done to death. The time dilation, you might all know, is a real thing that is also part of Einstein's general relativity. And Kip Thorne did all the calculations himself. So in that movie, it's very accurate. And in the movie, the black hole is enormous and it's rotating at nearly the speed of light. So it has this, what they say is what they call as a gentle singularity. So you could actually cross the event horizon and not be torn apart. Anyway, I think that'll do it for this video. So I'll see you next time. And if you haven't already, please apply some time derivative of momentum onto the subscribe button.